Wave Sound audiobooks present an unabridged recording of Less Stuff, Simple Zero Waste Steps to a Joyful and Clutter-Free Life by Lindsay Miles, narrated by Rachael Tidd. Introduction. Do you feel like you have too much stuff? Do you love the idea of decluttering, getting rid of the non-essentials and making space in your life for the things that are truly important, but you're not quite sure where to start? Do you worry about waste and hold on to things you know in your heart you don't need because you can't bear the thought of throwing them in the bin? Would you like to find a way of letting go that doesn't mean contributing to landfill or overloading the charity shops? Is your stuff making you feel a little bit guilty? Do you want to let go of the guilt once and for all? When we think about how we love to spend our time, we don't think about sorting or cleaning or tidying. We want to spend less time doing the boring stuff and more time on the things that matter. Things like catching up with friends and family, connecting with others, and pursuing our dreams. Mess and clutter stand in the way of our productivity, stress us out, and keep us stuck. Our stuff stands in the way of the lives we dream about. Decluttering does not come naturally to me. I have more hoarding tendencies than minimalist tendencies, or at least I did. Yet over time, I've learned to let go of things that I don't need. I've created space and freed up time. I've recognized that my possessions were holding me back and making me feel anxious and guilty. I've found freedom from the pursuit of more, and as a result of letting go of things that had a hold on me, I'm happier than I've ever been. I've found my enough. Want to know how I got from there to here? Let me tell you my story. Decluttering is a skill, and like so many skills, it comes down to practice. I had neither at the start of my journey. When I think about why I was hoarding stuff in the first place, there were a couple of reasons. One was that I cared about waste. I wasn't going to sling perfectly useful items in the bin, and I hadn't actually stopped to think about the alternatives. I was the person keeping things just in case. However, there was more to it than that. I'd never needed to declutter. I'd never learned to let things go. Somehow I'd let the fact that stuff was inherently useful blur the real question. Was it useful to me? As a kid, my bedroom was spacious, which meant there was plenty of room for stuff. I loved to collect things. There was never any need to get rid of anything, nor any inclination to do so. As I grew too old for toys and games, they were simply stored in the attic for later. I was never encouraged to part with my things, and so I didn't. When I left school and moved across the country to study, later travelling and then renting, my excess stuff was stored at my parents' place. I never had to deal with these things to ask myself if I really needed them. By storing them, I put thinking about them aside. Every Christmas and birthday, I'd accumulate more stuff. When I started working and began to earn my own money, I'd buy things that I liked or needed or wanted to purchase to cheer myself up. The amount of stuff I owned grew. I began to notice that the things I was receiving as gifts weren't things that I needed. They were better versions of things that I already had, with which there was nothing wrong, or they were similar to things that I already had. Another handbag, another necklace, another pair of shoes. I justified keeping this stuff by telling myself that even if it wasn't useful now, it could be in the future. I'd confuse liking something with a reason to buy it or to keep it. I had a wardrobe full of clothes I didn't wear, which made me feel guilty every time I looked at them. Yet I always felt like I had nothing to wear, which would spur me to buy even more. But this only led to more guilt. Embracing second-hand shopping made things worse. There were so many bargains that I seemed to accumulate more than ever before. When I moved to Australia from the UK, you'd assume I'd have got rid of everything. I did get rid of the really big stuff, most of the furniture I owned and stuff that couldn't be stored at my parents' house. But you guessed it, the stuff that could be taken to my folks was packed into boxes and stored, just in case. In Australia, starting afresh, I was determined not to acquire unnecessary stuff. I deliberately chose a small flat. Yet, as the months passed, my home filled up with stuff I needed, along with stuff I thought I needed, and stuff I simply liked the look of. I started to notice my home was feeling squishy. Should I move to a bigger place? It was a turning point. I didn't want to pay more rent just to store a bunch of things I rarely used. I didn't need more storage. I needed less stuff. That was when my journey really began. Bear in mind, I was somebody who had never really tried to declutter before. Plus, I was fixated on this idea of not wasting stuff. It was a recipe for disaster. The first time I decided to declutter, it was a complete disaster. I dedicated a long weekend to the process. For 3 days, I mostly sat in a chair dreaming of how I wanted my space to be decluttered already, yet I was very reluctant to find anything to get rid of. I thought I was willing, but when it came down to it, I needed it all. At the end of the long weekend, I had decluttered a single box of stuff. Despite this failure, I was determined to keep going. I could see the benefits that came with a life with less stuff, and that's what kept me motivated to continue trying. I came across the concept of minimalism, the practice of intentionally living with less and letting go of the excess. Some of the ideas minimalists were writing about struck a chord with me, but while they were big on the why, they were less clear on the how. I was sold on the benefits, and the after pictures were great, but how had these minimalists gotten there? What were the secrets? I was frustrated that other people seemed to find decluttering and letting go so easy when I found it so hard. I put it down to the fact that I cared about waste when they perhaps did not. Without a method or a template to follow, I started trying things my own way, setting myself challenges, trying different things or the same thing over and over. I started to notice patterns and to understand why I was resisting. Then I had an epiphany, a realization that decluttering and caring about waste actually go hand in hand. Decluttering doesn't have to be about wasting stuff. It's about identifying stuff that we own that is going to waste because we don't use it or don't like it or don't need it, and finding a better place for it, a place where it will actually be used. Decluttering does not have to mean landfill. We can find new homes for our things or places where the resources can be used again. Actually, it's an important part of the process. Decluttering can be the opposite of waste. Once I changed my perspective, I began to make real progress. The start may have been shaky and slow, but once I really understood what I was resisting and allowed myself time, the results came much more quickly. I learned to turn the guilt around. Getting rid of things I didn't use or need wasn't a reason to feel guilty. Keeping them was. Even decluttering my wardrobe, which I'd been struggling with despite hearing that it's the easiest place to tackle, came within my grasp. As I let more go, my idea of enough began to shift. I'd declutter down to what I considered the essentials, then realize that there were still more things to let go of. Today, I'm happy that I'm close to my enough, but I'm not perfect, and I'm still experimenting with less. I want to be comfortable and not take it to extremes, but I'm no longer exasperated with stuff or endless piles of clutter. I no longer have a full wardrobe, but nothing to wear. I don't know how many items I own, and I'm not interested in counting, but I know where everything is, more or less, and what everything is. There are no mystery boxes or random drawers or ominous cupboards. If I see something pretty in a shop, I acknowledge that I like it, but I don't feel the urge to buy it. If other people try to offload their unwanted things on me, I politely decline. Decluttering my own stuff is hard enough without taking on other people's guilt. I've redefined how I think of waste, too. If I have things I no longer need, I can let go of them responsibly. I may not need them, but if they still have life in them, they can be passed on to someone who can make use of them. It is more wasteful to keep things I don't need than it is to let them be used to their full potential. It took me 3 years to get here. 3 long years. I would have arrived a whole lot sooner if some of the insights I had along the way had revealed themselves earlier. The benefits of hindsight and experience would have been invaluable. As a way to document the lessons I learned and help others struggling with the same things as me, I started my blog, Treading My Own Path, in 2013. Writing about living with less stuff and less waste, and how I've turned zero waste and minimalist ideals into actionable solutions, I've been able to share my journey and help thousands of readers find their enough, make peace with their possessions, and let go of the unnecessary without sending it all to landfill. Decluttering doesn't have to be a never-ending process. It can be challenging and it can take time, but there is an end, and you can get there if you take the right approach. I hope that sharing my experiences will help to make your decluttering journey a speedier and more productive one than mine. I hope you can learn from my mistakes and benefit from the strategies I'm sharing. If I can do it, I know that you can do it too. This book is a guide for those of us who don't find decluttering easy, but who can see that letting go of excess stuff is necessary if we are to create more space and meaning in our lives. It is a guide for those of us who want to declutter, but who also care about where things end up when we let them go. We want to make the most of what we have, figure out what we need, and responsibly let go of the rest. Less stuff offers structure, motivation, and support to guide you as you decide what to let go of it, and how to break the cycle. We'll talk about the why and the bigger picture. We'll discuss barriers and the obstacles that you may come across with ideas on how to overcome them. We'll delve into the how. So many guides seem to skip straight from the before to the after with no mention of how. Less stuff will take you through your home step by step and help you choose which things to let go. We'll also talk about how to let go of your things responsibly. If you care about waste, you'll find this section particularly important. We'll discuss what's next, techniques for keeping clutter at bay, and tips for making this a one-time journey, because there's no fun in doing it all again, is there? My aim is to show you that a life with less stuff is achievable, possible, and within your grasp, and give you the tools to make it happen. I know decluttering can be hard. I've been there. I've experienced the struggles and the challenges and the frustration. I've also experienced the wins and the successes and the triumphs, and I know that a life with less is possible. I've seen the benefits of decluttering firsthand, and I want to help you see them too. Let's do this together. The bigger picture. 1. Zero waste versus minimalism. Zero waste and minimalism sound like opposites. Surely one is about hanging on to stuff and throwing nothing away, and the other is about discarding everything. Despite their seemingly different ideals, they actually have the same philosophy, wasting less. It's just that they approach it from different angles. What is zero waste? Imagine if there was no need for landfill. What if the things we purchased were made well, built to last, and designed in such a way that they could be readily repaired, easily repurposed, or their materials simply recovered to make new products? Rather than burying the things we no longer need in a hole in the ground for all eternity, or incinerating them into ash and smoke, these items, or the materials they are made from, could become resources for others to use for years to come. That is the philosophy behind zero waste. If we look at how things work in nature, there is no waste. Nature cycles and recycles everything: air, water, nutrients. Humans are the only species known to create waste. And what a lot of waste we create. The reality is that many of the things we purchase are not made to last a lifetime, and they aren't easy to repair if and when they do break. When items are made of mixed materials, such as wood, different types of plastic, and different metals, it is not easy to recycle them. It is hard to know what to do with these things other than toss them in the bin. This isn't an accident on the part of manufacturers. Many manufacturers deliberately design products to break or wear out. There's even a term for it, planned obsolescence, which means designed for the dump. Manufacturers do this to keep us buying their products. There's a balance they need to find. If things break too easily, we might not go back to their product. If an item lasts forever, they won't be able to sell us a new one. Products need to last just long enough for us to trust the manufacturer enough to buy a replacement, but expire quickly enough that they can sell us a new product as soon as possible. The old item? That likely ends up in landfill. Surely things can be done differently. That is where zero waste comes in. Zero waste is both an industrial design term and a lifestyle philosophy. The term was first coined in the 1970s by a chemist called Dr. Paul Palmer, who noticed that companies in Silicon Valley were discarding chemicals that were still perfectly usable. He set up a company, Zero Waste Systems Incorporated, to find uses and resell all of the chemicals that were being discarded. Palmer recognized that the best way to avoid waste is for everything to be reused indefinitely. And this can only be achieved if reuse is designed into products rather than only being considered once a product reaches the end of its useful life. He saw zero waste as a design principle. Most of us are not product designers. We are people who buy things in good faith and only realize that these things are not durable or fixable or recyclable once they break or wear out, and we are faced with putting them in the bin. But we still have the power to make a difference through our everyday choices and the purchases we make. This is what the zero waste lifestyle is all about: how individuals can reduce the rubbish they create at home. The zero waste lifestyle movement started in 2008 when Bea Johnson began her blog Zero Waste Home, detailing how her family avoided throwing anything in their bin. Instead, they focused on refusing things they did not need, reducing and reusing, with recycling as the last resort. Today, there are thousands of people doing what they can to limit what they put in the bin. Designing products that can be reused in perpetuity and not throwing anything in the bin might sound fantastic, but is it realistic? Well, it is true that zero waste in its purest form doesn't actually exist, not yet. That's why zero waste is often described as a set of guiding principles, a goal, or a philosophy. We might not be able to achieve perfection, but we can still do what we can with what we have. We can make better choices, not just with our purchases in the future, but also with how we dispose of the things that we own now. Sending nothing to landfill doesn't mean simply storing stuff that's broken, irreparable, and useless in our homes instead of putting it in the rubbish bin. It doesn't mean making our living spaces a pseudo-landfill. It's about choosing to use resources wisely. Zero waste living means refusing products and packaging that are single use or poorly made, flimsy, and non-repairable. Reducing our consumption to only what is necessary. Necessary may differ from person to person. It's a personal choice, of course, and we all have different needs, but it comes down to mindful consumption. Not buying stuff simply because it was on sale at a bargain price, looked appealing in the advert, the next door neighbour has one. Reusing items we already have and choosing reusables over single-use items. Repairing items when they break rather than simply chucking them out in favour of new ones, which is why choosing well-made and easy-to-repair products is important, or repurposing them so that they can continue to be useful. Recycling only what cannot be reused, repaired, or repurposed. Rotting or composting the scraps that cannot be dealt with any other way. The zero-waste lifestyle follows these, and as a result, next to nothing is sent to landfill. What is minimalism? In a world that teaches us that accumulating stuff is good, that happiness can be found through shopping, and that more is better, minimalism is a deliberate decision to slow down, to look at our possessions and our lifestyles. It is about letting go of the excess, getting rid of the non-essential, and focusing on what brings joy and creates meaning in our lives, experiences, connections, and people. The things that make us truly happy are not things at all. Minimalism is about finding freedom from the pursuit of more and contentment with what we already have, or maybe even a little bit less. Our material-obsessed lifestyle is relatively new. Many of our grandparents grew up during war and economic depression. They often didn't have the material comforts we take for granted today, or even their basic needs met. The baby boomer generation of the 1950s were the first to be able to buy everything they needed. Having seen the struggles their parents went through, it's easy to understand why the baby boomers saw possessions as a means to happiness. Up to a point, of course, this is true, but they met their basic needs and kept on going, accumulating more and more. Maybe it's the hunter-gatherer instinct that we use to our advantage for thousands of years. We just haven't learned how to use the off switch. The truth is, this explosion of consumerism hasn't resulted in a corresponding growth in happiness. In fact, happiness is thought to have peaked in the 1960s. Instead, we're stressed, we're time poor, and we're unhappy. And buying our way out of it hasn't worked. Our stuff has begun to own us, plus we're using up resources at an alarming rate. Minimalism is not about wasting stuff, and it is definitely not about chucking stuff in the bin to make space to acquire new stuff. It's not about only owning 100 items or never spending any money. It is not about living in a modern home with sleek designer furniture or living in a shack in the wilderness. Maybe for some minimalists, these lifestyle choices do apply, but for many more, none of these apply. It is not about following rules, except the ones we make ourselves, or pursuing the least amount of things. Minimalism is simply a journey to enough. To discovering the right amount of things for us and letting go of the excess. It is about spending less money on stuff so there's less debt and more freedom. It's about spending less time cleaning and tidying and organizing and shopping so there's more time for the stuff that's really important, spending time with friends and family, hobbies, helping others, and getting involved with our local community. Can you be a zero-waste minimalist? Zero waste and minimalism, are they really that different? I don't think so. At the heart of both is the idea of intentional living, realizing what we truly need, making do, and choosing well. Being mindful, making conscious choices, and living life with purpose. Two sides of the same coin. Of course, you can aspire to one lifestyle but not the other. There are plenty of people passionate about zero waste who are not minimalists, and many minimalists who do not live a zero waste lifestyle. You can be zero waste, you can be minimalist, you can be both, and you can be neither. When it comes to labels, some of us love them and some of us don't. If you're a fan of moderation and these labels just seem too extreme for you, don't use them. This isn't about striving for perfection. It's about doing the best we can. You can know you have too much stuff and want to have less without wanting to call yourself a minimalist. You can be keen to recycle more and send less to landfill without wanting to do away with your rubbish bin entirely and be zero waste. We all have our own version of enough. Find yours. It doesn't matter what anybody else's looks like, nor what they call it. This is about you, your stuff, your relationship to your stuff, and how you're going to change that for the better. 2. Why decluttering can be good for the planet. Decluttering, when done right, is actually good for the planet. Decluttering is not good for the planet if everything that is being decluttered ends up at the nearest landfill site, regardless of its condition and usability. Decluttering is good when we try our best to find new homes for the things we no longer need, repurpose and repair what we can, and recycle the rest. It's good for the planet because it frees up existing resources and reduces the demand for the extraction of raw materials and the manufacture of new products. Humans use a lot of resources. We use more resources than we have, or rather, we are using them faster than they can be renewed.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.